Hey everyone, this is your host Chris G from Blurred's Eye View. And if you haven't heard about Anchor, it's the easiest way to make a podcast. Here, let me explain. First, it's free. You definitely can't beat that. Plus, there's creation tools that allow you to record and edit your podcast right from your phone or your computer. Anchor will distribute your podcast for you so it can be heard on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, and many more. You can make money from your podcast with no minimum listenership, and it's everything you need to make a podcast and more. Download the free Anchor app or go to anchor.fm to get started.
In the sky, it's a bird, it's a plane. Flying high, I emerge through the flames. Have no fear, I'm here, so stand back. Melanin, activate, the name is Super Black. In the sky, it's a bird, it's a plane. Flying high, I emerge through the flames. Have no fear, I'm here, so stand back. Melanin, activate, the name is Super Black. Imagine that, a future that's super black. Long as your skin brown, your superpowers intact. What would your powers be? Just hope it ain't super whack. Spatial manipulation, create a portal that's black. Maybe just super speed, time travel to run it back. Or chi manipulation to keep my spirit intact. As I encounter evils the world face, demons the world makes, I needed the world to stay. Rest in peace to Chadwick, they killed all the Black Panthers. Told us white lies, I still marvel at black answers. Suits in D.C., pray it lead to a civil war. It ain't no Justice League, what's the need to be civil for? Propelled like the juggernaut, it's clear ain't no stopping this. The world in grave danger, who can stop the apocalypse? They killed all the heroes, the new ones don't really care. But if you need me, put your fist up in the air. Yeah, in the sky, it's a bird, it's a plane. Flying high, I emerge through the flames. Have no fear, I'm here, so stand back. Melanin, activate, the name is Super Black. In the sky, it's a bird, it's a plane. Flying high, I emerge through the flames. Have no fear, I'm here, so stand back. Melanin, activate, the name is Super Black.
Thank you for watching Blurred's Eye View, and if you haven't already, hit that notification bell, or if you're listening to us in your car or at work, subscribe to wherever you listen to podcasts, follow us on IG, and check out the link in the bio. I'm your host, Chris Fury, and with me is our very own Lady Deathstrike of the team, and sometimes she's sour, sometimes she's sweet, Candy B.
What's up? Hi. You see, I'm calm, I'm zen-like, because my birthday month is over, so.
You know what,
We're calm now.
We're calm.
For now, I'm gonna go back into the hibernate. It's like fucking Jeepers Creepers. I'm gonna go back a certain amount of time. I'll
every
be back.
21 years.
Every 21 years,
reemerges. We have two guests with us tonight: Lee Juwasu and Sequence, and they're here with us. They're talking about their martial arts skills, anime, and stunt choreography, and very much more. But before we get to that, Candy B, what have you been up to?
I'm making a list and checking it twice because it's almost Christmas. No, I'm kidding. I don't like Christmas like that. I'm not excited about it. I've been trying to finish planning. I'm literally in the middle of making a page for it, this adult prom. I'm going to throw an adult prom. So for those of you that missed yours, that didn't like yours, if you want to turn up, it's going to be in Cleveland, Ohio. It is going to be free booze for a certain amount of time. We ain't going to do the whole night free booze, but we're going to have open bar for a couple hours. There's gonna
we don't
be,
have money like that.
Yeah, we ain't got it like that yet, but there's going to be great food, vegan options. DJ's going to be popping. We're going to decide who the prom king and queen are based off of best dress, kind of like a cute little voting showtime at the Apollo thing like that. But I think it's going to be a nice positive event to bring to the city to give people a reason to dress up because I'm always about that. So just trying to get my event coordinating and hosting gigs together.
But tell them what the theme is.
Oh, okay. So the theme is, are y'all ready?
Y'all better be ready.
It's for the 99 in the 2000. Period. Because we're always up here. It's going to be so cute. So it's going to be 80% of the time the DJ is going to be playing them throwback jams. But it's going to be cute. I think it's going to go great. And all I need to do is throw one successful event and then I can keep them rolling in from there. Because I'm serious about working for myself because I'm tired of these 9-to-5 people. I'm
Tell
tired.
Me about it. That is the preaching of the gospel. The 9-to-5 is the pain.
When did you say that was again?
It's going to be June 25th. I already rented out the ballroom, put down the deposit June 25th next year. And I'm going to be officially putting the tickets on sale, January. I'm just basically finishing in the next 3 months here, really 2 months now, tying all the loose ends up. I'm kind of obsessed with planning way, way in advance. That way you have enough room for shit to be fucked up and for you to fix it. But I had to pull the trigger on the ballroom, which is really pretty because it has the chandeliers and it's just going to be nice to decorate. And there's going to be like those, you remember those old school, like those backdrops that would be in clubs or at like your prom and you stand in front of that for the pictures and stuff. It's going to be corny, tacky, but it's still going to be cute. So we're going to have stuff like that too.
Now at the same time, I want those who are going to attend, if you don't have magnesium, let's just put it like that. If you don't have magnesium, just bring the Advil or whatever it is you have to bring.
Because we're gonna be on. It's gonna be from 6 to 12, and it's gonna be a nice time. So I'm excited. A nice safe time. We ain't gonna have no drama, okay?
Right.
In the 2000s, so it don't really matter, right?
What'd you say?
I said Megan wasn't really around during the 2000s, so it really don't matter, right?
Well, before Megan, there was Sierra. So if you ain't got them Sierra knees,
Sierra knees,
don't worry about it. You can just stand up and whine to Sean Paul and them. That's it. Yeah, just vibe with it. We're going to figure it out. But that's what I've been up to.
I had the opportunity over this weekend to check out Blackest Night on Amazon Prime.
Okay.
If you love vampire films, Buffy the Vampire television style, this movie is it. This is an all black and brown cast. This is taking place in New Orleans. Our boy Keith David is in it. So for those who don't know who Keith David is, he is the voice of everyone's favorite gargoyle, Goliath. The only one that matters. Another show that had a predominantly black and brown cast was Gargoyles. I liked it. I liked where it was going with it. You know, you hear a lot of stories, you hear a lot of stuff like on social media and everything online, talking about telling our own type of horror stories, supernatural stories, especially after the success of Lovecraft Country, knowing that we can tell that story and be put into that light. And here we have a lead, young black girl who's killing vampires along with her Latino best friend and a young boy she likes, and it works. Enjoy it.
The representation's important, which is why I'm like obsessed with the gentleman we have as guests, because I like seeing us occupying spaces that you don't normally see us, especially when we're rocking. I know this may be like something small to some people, but when we're rocking our hair a certain way and occupying space, that always does it for me, because sometimes, you know, they want us there in a certain way. So they want you in the Caesar. They don't want the fro. They don't want the dreads. They don't want anything that they can really say, this is black. So I like being able to see us and we be blackety black, black.
Yeah, and yeah, it was fun. It was fun. I'm gonna give it another watch because it was just there's a key moment, and this has been said way before this movie came out. This has been said. They talk about it with Blade. They say, well, how can Blade walk in daylight? It's the melanin in his skin. The blacker you are, you can walk in the daylight in time. And that's one of the things they actually addressed. And I'm just like, yo, I like what you did there. Thank you. That was something amazing to watch. I had a lot of fun checking it out. I will be checking it out. So before we get to our guests, we got some blurred news to talk about.
Uh-oh. I'm gonna hit it.
I'm not saying uh-oh.
So as we all know, Christopher Jamal Evans is now the voice of Buzz Lightyear. It's the new movie Buzz Lightyear or the new trailer.
You mean Cuz Lightyear?
Yeah, we'll talk about that in a second. Buzz Lightyear film drop. It's still made the same way as the other Toy Story films was, but this is the story about the real Buzz Lightyear, not the toy. So Christopher Jamal Evans, you'll wonder why I keep calling him that, but you'll find out in a second because that man's middle name really is Jamal. This is some of the looks they have.
His face.
But this is our man right here. This is how he looks in the film. Looks good. But you know, Black Twitter, we can't leave nothing well enough alone.
It's the heart for me.
It's the heart.
I'm like, why they do that to him?
Buzz Lightskin is what they were calling him. Buzz Lightskin.
Yes.
So now we got Vishon, and then we got Buzz Lightyear. Buzz
Nothing Lightskin. Will ever beat Vishon because I was not expecting them to do that. Like, and the fact that there were people cosplaying that, nothing will ever beat that. Because I know good and well, Paul is his name, right? Paul Bethany, mm-hmm. I think that plays him. I know he wasn't expected to go viral like that. That was the last thing he was thinking.
Vishon is part brother because he's made in Wakanda.
Definitely that.
That was vibranium.
Very much that.
His body was made out of vibranium. So here it is.
One of us.
We had the Boba Fett trailer drop, the Book of Boba Fett. That drops in December, actually. The trailer just dropped yesterday. Temuera Morrison, who plays Boba Fett in the prequels for the Star Wars films, reprises his role as the titular title card for Boba Fett. Our very favorite, fan favorite, Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. alumni and voice of Mulan, Ming-Na Wei, plays Fennec Shan, who's also a fan favorite from The Mandalorian. So that drops in December.
Get your checks.
Yeah, I'm getting your checks. Good Lord. Ming-Na Wei is probably the only person who has been an action star for Marvel, played a Disney princess, and there's one other thing she's done, and I can't remember what it is, but it has something to do with Marvel and Disney. And I'm like, good Lord, just get the money.
Yeah, her manager's working overtime. I'm not mad at it.
So we also had the Morbius trailer drop. You know, Jared Leto would be playing Michael Morbius. For those who don't know, Morbius is the half man, half vampire in the Spider-Man universe, in the Spider-Man comics and television animated series. And this was supposed to come out last year, but you know, COVID. This looks promising.
I don't know why I'm not excited. I'm not moved.
I think it's, you know what I think it is? It's the long wait. And this is under Sony. So there's that as well, which has a really, they're just.
I would like to attribute it to the long wait because I feel like I had a little bit of fatigue when it came to Black Widow. Mm-hmm. I wasn't really jumping on that. But even when they were showing, you know, just clips and stuff when this was first coming around, it was like, it's going to have to be one of those movies for me where somebody else says they saw it and it was bomb because I'm not rushing.
I mean, if it's anything like Venom, then I'm like, okay, then it's doable. You know, it's a doable thing.
Yeah,
you know?
It's cool.
This is DC's boy. He's also in the film.
Child. Bye.
Hey, he's come from burlap sack sweaters to fighting vampires, I guess. This is some of the other screenshots. This really does look good.
That looks good.
You know, our boy Michael Keaton will be making an appearance as, you know, not as the Vulture, but there is a scene with him in it. So something happens where
that's like one of the main reasons to even watch this, to be honest.
Right. Yeah. Michael Keaton is the man. Let's just face it. It's our Ronin on the soundboards. DC, what's going on, baby?
I'm a nigga ninja. What's up? Man, I know y'all didn't think I was gonna miss real live ninjas. Like, yeah, I've missed a lot of things, but ninjas? Shit. I missed birth before that.
You missed birth? Don't let you.
Won't be my birth, but how's it going, fellas?
Oh, man. This is our Ronin, our nigga ninja, as he said. It's on the boards. It's DC. We were talking
y'all ninjas,
about...
I'm nigga.
We were talking about the new Morbius trailer. And I said your boy was in it. Your boy right here.
Your best friend.
God damn it.
Your best friend.
What does this nigga have to do for this role?
Well, apparently crying in the cave with the burlap sack helped.
It's a vampire. What more do you want from me?
No. But, and then we said Michael Keaton's in it. Michael Keaton is playing. Good. When is he not, though? That's the thing.
Yeah, I know. He's an OG.
Here's some of the other screenshots. This obviously ties into the Spider-Man mythos.
That's literally just a regular shot of Jared Leto leaving his apartment. And that's how he looks all the time.
Doesn't it look like that?
Every day.
that's a regular picture. Someone took that with their cell phone.
You know, and here's something for the ladies. You know,
hello. not the darker meat I prefer, but we'll deal, ladies. We will deal.
Now,
it's 2021, they settle it. Yeah, it looks like it's gonna be a good movie, though. I can't wait.
It does. Guess who drops on Netflix tomorrow? Countdown to fucking midnight. Might as well be because our girl in The Harder They Fall.
Yeah, you know how to write with Black Jesus and the disciples.
Indeed.
Yo. This is accurate.
Disciples. They are on the rise.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. We few short on this picture.
We few short, but you know, we may not. They might not all be there just yet, but. Trust me,
I can't
coming.
Wait for that to drop neither.
But yeah, that's coming on Netflix tomorrow, November 3rd. You know, we got Lakeith Stanfield in this thing.
So good.
Zazie Beetz and Jonathan Majors. Yeah, damn near everybody. And that's if running black Hollywood.
Right? Yeah, dude, they were like,
come on over.
Even if you had something to do, all I'd have to hear is Idris Elba, I'm free. What are you talking about? Sign me the fuck up.
Like when you got Jonathan Majors is becoming like that guy. Like he's in every freaking thing right now.
Yeah.
Like making moves. Like I can't wait for this thing.
Is that Delano the Shields?
Yep. Delroy
See,
Lindo.
You know what's crazy? Him too. But when you look at it, because he got a distinct face that no matter how fuzzy it is, you can tell it's him. That's how I knew it was him in the middle. Yeah.
Not a distinct face, no matter how fuzzy. Goodbye.
But you know,
can I drop that midnight?
Midnight. You know, if Netflix is playing their cards right, they better drop it after midnight.
I thought they were gonna do it on Friday. I'm bugging.
I thought so too, but I think they moved their dates around.
On a Wednesday, man. I feel
It does.
They're trying to set us up for failure.
Well, you know what? Disney Plus was
they let the Wahotes drop on Friday, but the brothers got to drop on a Wednesday, knowing people got to work on a hump day.
Well, it's just gonna be a lot of call offs. But speaking of Regina King, our girl just got the star on the Walk of Fame. Yeah, it did. It took way too long.
Look at that. This sister been put. 45-year-old woman.
Look at that. That's kind of gorgeous.
Oh, I like what she wrote. That's nice.
Yeah. Well, she puts, you know, for this sister been putting
227, no place like home.
Right. Market
where it all started.
Make it yours. Where it all started. Right.
It's pretty Gina dope. King.
I'm so glad for her. I'm so happy for her. Like it's well earned. It's way past earned. So before we get to our guests, we're gonna go to our commercial break. So stay tuned.
Running low on energy, long days and even longer nights, tired of all the other energy drinks and bars promise you a lot and never delivering? Need to make it through work, but want a product that can keep up with your busy lifestyle? Want no longer. Try Chef's Chocolate Salty Balls. The balls that are so smooth and with a load of nutrients and vitamins to really get you up and bouncing off the walls. Made with all natural ingredients and healthy junk to satisfy even the pickiest eater. Chef's Chocolate Salty Balls are sold everywhere where you buy your junk. And now, for those who want that extra kick in the butt, comes Chef's Heavy Duty Chocolate Salty Balls with 120% more caffeine than the leading brand. Disclaimer, this product has not been approved by the FDA or World Health Association. Warning, this product is not intended for consumption by children, elderly people, or women who are pregnant or may become pregnant. You might even get pregnant.
I swear we ain't shit.
No, you. I didn't make that. That's you.
We're gonna play that at the adult prom next year.
Absolutely not. Security.
We'll be giving out chocolate.
I'm just here to press buttons so I don't get fined.
Security.
So, what made you guys want to become ninjas? Because that was just off the. What made you want to learn the way of the Shaolin?
So we'll start with our guests. We got two literal masters at their craft. We got Lee and Sequence here, and they are martial arts artists, stunt choreographers, and anime heads on top of that. So we'll start with you, Sequence, to introduce yourself to everybody.
Well, hello, everybody. My name is Sequence Henry, other words known as Running Fist Ronin or That Boy Ronin on IG. I've been doing martial arts since I was 3 years old, and I continue to do it now. I love it.
Yeah. That's dope. That is dope. Lee, There you go.
Can I say
greetings, people?
Oh, good.
I'm sorry, Lee. But I also a martial artist, entrepreneur, business owner, player, good boyfriend, you know, all of the above.
Not bomb one, he is, because you know, I'm gonna plug my little show. They were on Candid Convos with Candy.
Yes,
D,
and they were.
These brothers were so impressive to me. Like, I couldn't believe this much maturity and just mental stability, which is huge. I mean, like, we laugh about it, but that's a big thing amongst men, let alone men of color, coming from you guys. And he's a good man. And, you know, ain't nobody talking crazy in his inbox because we asked about that, too. And if they are, he's shutting them down because he's taken. Happily, period. Yes, that's right. Period.
Let's put it on there.
Exclamation point. With the T.
That's
with
a good T. Man. A good man. And he light skin and a good man. You know, that's a rare combination. They be out here. They be out here. I don't know.
I want to say that was a compliment. A little backhanded. But you know.
He knows it's all love. But continue.
Lee, you're up.
Yeah, snap. Okay, so there's an anime called Kenichi. And Kenichi is about this dude who's a freaking weakling. He can't even walk with his feet in front of him. And he starts getting beat up at school. So he meets somebody and she decides she's going to help him learn all of the martial arts. So watching this anime and eventually reading the manga, I decided I was going to learn all of the martial arts. And after years of fighting people and getting beaten up and spending a lot of money on weapons, I realized that the pursuit of mastery and a skill is what's going to make you great, not necessarily collecting a whole bunch of stuff. And so I decided to pick up martial arts and hone in on martial arts after this traveling. And it led me to meet a lot of cool people and learn a lot of cool stuff and do a lot of cool things.
Now, I'll say I've watched both of your brothers work, some of your videos and stuff like that, and some of your pictures. Look, for folks who are listening or even watching, these cats are the real deal. Who do you admire to meet? Who's your favorite in martial arts?
Ooh, that's hard. I'm gonna let Lee go first. Lee, you go first.
Put him on the spot.
Dang. Snap, see?
You stole my questions.
Okay. There's someone by the name of Latif Crowder. And Latif Crowder, I believe he's Brazilian. He does an art called capoeira. And if y'all are familiar with Tekken, Latif Crowder is literally Eddie Gordo. He's the person Eddie Gordo is based off of.
And fun fact, he was also the stunt double for Chadwick Boseman in Black Panther.
There it is.
Wait,
knowledge.
Yep.
You think it's a game? Get fired with these bitches one time.
Knowledge.
Not knowledge. Their faces. His face.
Putting in work.
Trust me, Kristen's seen Black Panther 50-11 times, so he would know more than anybody.
It'll be 50-20.
Not putting him on blast how many times he watched it.
I mean, I've seen Black Panther's hoodie pajamas.
I have no shame. Have you seen the background? I'm like, I have no shame.
Yes, a cup of cocoa.
Hold on, hands.
And his first slip is the slow sip. Go ahead, Chad. Beat their ass. Beat their ass, Chad.
You didn't even call him Chad.
That's right. Who do you admire in martial arts?
Oh, he's also he said Latif, right? Lee. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
He's also an actor for the main character in The Mandalorian as well.
Yes.
Oh, nice. Yes. Okay.
Yes. Boom. Mind blown again.
Getting checked.
Black Panther, but all right. Well, I guess you might be right. But
no, he's right. Trust me, brother. He don't even know. He know martial arts. He know comic books and movies. That's his mastery.
He said, "Aye."
But I take a lot of information from a lot of different martial artists, regardless if they're famous or not. I really focus on work and their character towards their work. So and just because you see actors or martial artists on television or movies doesn't mean they're actual martial artists. Mm-hmm. So that's why I do my homework. But we're not going to get too much into detail. But if I had to choose someone that I would want to meet, I somewhat admire and have grown a profound fascinate, been fascinated with in the last few years, I would say Michael Jai White.
I was thinking you was gonna go there, but I didn't want to put words in my V's.
Reason being is because over my years of training, the thing that I've seen him do can't really be explained just from looking at it. So for me to understand exactly what he's doing, far as technique, philosophy, or just the understanding of the principles behind why he does the things that he do, far as martial arts, I would have to meet him in person. You know, I don't like to judge people based off of their movies or things that they do. I would prefer to see it in person. You know, so he is someone that sparks my curiosity, far as like a level of excellence. Plus he's black. You know, he's in the industry, so I'm curious about how he maneuvers through the industry. Because eventually I would like to be in that position as well. So it's not just the martial arts aspect. It's him being a martial artist, being black, and then being proficient at his craft to where he has to be outstanding enough to catch everyone's attention, regardless mm-hmm. of race or whatever. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. He's interesting. So I would like to meet him, ask him some questions.
That's dope. I have some videos that you did, that you sent me, and this is a combination of a few of your cohorts.
Mm-hmm.
None of you niggas walk in the dark alley alone, I tell you that much. I commend y'all, because that does take years of skill and dedication, you know what I mean? Just the discipline to stay in that art firm You know what I mean? Oh shit.
Gee, Groovy's shit. In the building.
But oh shit. REA. Okay. Anywho, like I was saying, man, the dedication that it takes to stay in that that art form and to master it, I commend y'all for that. Cause you know what I mean? Some people don't have that level of dedication to stay in something like that and to be able to be great at it. I commend y'all. And y'all still young, so y'all got plenty of time to do what y'all want to do, you know what I mean? So stay with it. Like, just seeing that alone, I was like, damn, y'all dope. Yeah. I ain't gonna lie. You know, I like to let people know the truth, and y'all dope as hell. I don't just say that just to say it. Like, just seeing y'all when y'all was on Candy's show, the brief moment I caught it, because I was had some other stuff to do. So, but you guys are dope for real, man. So, I want to say myself, y'all the shit. I don't know too many black ninjas. Yeah. So, I know y'all, so I can say that now. But
man, honestly, put y'all on the payroll somewhere.
keep up with y'all craft, man, because it's easy to get complacent sometimes or feel like you're not doing it, man, but y'all doing it. I don't care what nobody tell y'all.
So and I like that you're doing it as a team. Sorry to interrupt you, Chris.
No,
I like that it's a squadron and it's not this kind of competitive thing that you see amongst almost anybody that's in the same field, because I've seen it on and off in the cosplay world with different people where they act like one person can't just be doing their thing without it being some type of beef or just petty stuff. And I never got that vibe from the content I've been following from you guys that you've been putting up or Lee at all. And I love that it's a group. And I think I follow almost everybody in the squad that I saw in the video individually. Mm-hmm. And they're like DC said, they're really about their business, like on and off the court. And it's really, really cool to see a group. So I hope y'all get picked up. I hope Hollywood's paying attention and some contracts and checks is coming in because y'all doing it.
Yeah. So Lee, what have you ever become complacent? You know, DC mentioned complacency. So have you ever gotten to a point in your training where you've gotten a little complacent? You're like, okay, I got to snap out of it or anything like that?
Yeah, on a daily basis. You know how boring stretching is, bro? I would never, ever.
I believe him, yo. I don't know why, but I do.
Uh-oh, you
Quiet.
Cut out.
Yeah,
that's
his feet's a little bad.
Oh, is it back?
It's in and out. It's in and out.
Really?
That's you're weird. There. Yeah, you're good. You're good. You're good. You're there now.
Yes. The challenge is to get a split. And the only reason that I'm stretching right now is because I want to hit a split. Because there are the us that have splits and the us that do not have splits and the us that get splits, and you got to maintain the splits, and it's very difficult to maintain flexibility. It forces you to not be complacent. So you just take one day to not stretch and all your flexibility for the past 3 months goes away.
Oh, wow. So are you doing a little bit of, because I saw on, I want to say TikTok, Lizzo has a trainer that's teaching her how to do a split, and I guess however far her leg extended, they said that was day one. And I'm like, ain't no damn way you could learn like in a day to do a split. I'm like, where's the trainers at? So are you like at that stage where like from day one you had a lot of flexibility, or are you like, oh, I gotta work on this a bit more?
Yes, a whole lot of work.
I believe him. I just like how there's class systems in ninja them, like those who have splits and those who don't. Which makes you feel
that's a hell of a system to place it. You put yourself.
You in. Would. You'd have to put you your nose up just a little split. Bit at those that don't have the splits. Like, look at you, not splitting,
non-splitting ass motherfucker.
What about you, Sequence? Split. Has there ever been a point in your training, because you've been training since you were 3? You said, right?
Yes.
Has there ever been a point where you're just like, oh, screw this. I ain't on it today.
You know, first of all, being put in martial arts at a young age, I mean, you have no choice because, you know, your parents are looking after you. But there's always came a time where it's like, man, I don't want to do this shit no more, man. I don't want to go to class. I don't want to train no more. You know, but the discipline behind, or just, well, it was just something I had to basically learn. you know, I didn't always want to do certain things as a kid, but the thing is, when you grow up and you realize the benefits of sticking through it or being put in a position you didn't want to be in, it helps you along the way in the future. You know, so mm-hmm. Now you're having to do things that you don't want to do, but you know the benefits behind something that you don't like to do, but you complete it. You know, there's less behind it. But from, yeah, like I said, from 3 years old to now, it's always been like that. Even now, sometimes it's like, so I'm a teacher. Dude, I teach. So it's like, even sometimes, like, man, I don't want to teach. And I don't want to do this right now. You know, it's because my mind is expanding. You know, it's becoming more mature about things that are around me. Growing up, martial arts was, I thought that martial arts is the only thing that I was good at. So early when I came back and said, oh, I'm this, 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 and this, is because I've been working on that. So why not give myself credit? You know, I don't want to be known as just a martial artist.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, in anything that you do, you're gonna always be complacent, man. You gotta push through and figure out if this is really what you want to do. If not, move on to the next thing. You got time, right. You know, nothing but.
well, considering the fact you trained at such an early age, that sounds so much like your typical martial arts origin. It just does. I've been training since the time I was in the crib. No,
except for it's nothing tragic. Like, my parents were murdered in front of me at the age of three, right. And then I decided to train.
I like to learn a way to make them fear me. Well, I mean, that's no different than you. Like, you know, like athletes who at the age of birth are given a football or a basketball or something like that. That it does teach, because I've coached. It does that dedication. Like I said, it takes a lot to stay in that zone. You know what I mean? Especially when you're young. And there's all this temptation and the streets and people partying and drinking. That's the downfall of a lot of the youth, because they get caught up in that hype and they lose mm-hmm. focus. They lose dedication. I've seen players who had all the potential in the world, but they couldn't let go of the streets. And right. They, you know what I'm saying, lost their way. So that's why I said I commend y'all big time, because y'all being young and being able to do even when you young or old.
That's what's up.
Group and to keep one another aligned. You know that, you know, when he asked me for the video or asked me videos of myself, I could have easily sent things of just me, but the thing is, it's not about me. You know, I wouldn't be where I am if it wasn't for each individual person that was in that video.
It ain't me, it's we.
Or to learn something, you know, or to want to enhance my skills. So it's no longer about me, it's about the people around you that helped you develop your character, your being, your purpose, your reasoning, and a bigger vision when it comes to life, you know. And if you're selfish, you're never going to be able to see that.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why I love these guys that are around me. Each one of the team members they have a special place in my heart, you know. And I just so happen to get lucky to have individuals like this, and I know how important it is to keep them around, you know, because it's hard to find them nowadays. It's hard to find them. It's hard to find.
Yeah, it truly is when you have a clan of like-minded individuals whose goal aligns with everybody else's. It's a dope feeling, to be honest with you. And speaking of which, here's the other video that you sent me. I'm gonna show.
Mm-hmm.
Oh wait! Let me.
I want to like this.
DC was a bit mesmerized for a second there.
No, because I was in my head. I was playing all that out. You know, now you watch like all the old school like martial art flicks, and they had that montage of training. That's what that reminded me of, and I just always love those. You know what I'm saying? You see the side, this dude in the dojo, he getting ready to fight. I don't know. That's always dope to me. But no, y'all always do y'all, man, them two videos, y'all did your thing. And like I said, it's dope. I was a little mesmerized, though. I ain't gonna lie.
I'd be wanting to learn that stuff for all the wrong reasons. Like, say something.
Yeah, see, that's what I took karate for a little bit, and I was like, I'm in this for the wrong reasons. I just want to fight people.
It's not for the fight.
The reason to do this.
That is not the reason.
I only played football so I could hit people for the right reasons.
So,
but from a self-defense standpoint, it would be... that would be really dope to teach a self-defense class just specifically for women, because there's so many of us that end up in situations, regardless of age, where you feel helpless, whether you're out and about or, in my experience, actually in a relationship. And had I been able to feel like physically powerful against somebody who was like 6'3 and 200 something pounds, I still fought. But it's different when you know what you're doing to kind of, I guess, like, focus differently or anticipate how somebody would come at you. I think it would be a lot better for a lot of people that are in unfortunate situations like that. So, you know, that's another business venture for y'all if y'all ever wanted to get into that bag.
So I've taught
personal bodyguards.
Of course, seminars, training, visuals, videos. And women's self-defense was not my main priority as far as, like, teaching people. But after a few experiences and being out in the world a little bit more, I just changed my demographic to women. Because I went out to California and I actually threw a couple seminars out there. And one of my seminars that I threw, almost every lady in the class had some type of trauma, abuse that happened to them. And it was just so wild. Like, not one of them didn't have a situation that happened to them. You know, so to me, you know, having all this information as far as martial arts and self-defense and learning how to defend yourself and being self-aware and aware of your surroundings, why I would be doing an injustice if I didn't share this information. You know? And I feel that, you know, when it comes to ladies, man, I want them to be empowered. I have a lady myself. You know, I train her all the time. I'm constantly instilling things in her mind, where she's at home, where she's taking an Uber, where she's over there with her friends. And her friends know how she moves. She moves different. She doesn't move like prey anymore, you know?
Mm.
That's dope to say.
But it's true, though. I mean,
she doesn't move like prey anymore.
Know which people or what type of people to go at. You know, just like you have bullies in school growing up. They know the ones you can pick on. So it's just to pray. You know, you got to uphold yourself a lot differently. You got to say certain things. You have to look a certain type of way so you would be less likely to target it. And most people don't even know that. You know, that's just something so simple. You know, it's how you carry yourself.
I think that's a... I don't even know having a way to put that. But
what?
Yeah. Well, no, because this is why I named this episode The Way of the Ronin. Because here you have two brothers that are literally, they're in the field, they're practicing, they're telling you these different ways how to protect yourself, how to walk, how to, you know, present yourself, you know, in different fashions. And I think that's dope. Lee, I know you are going into are you in stunt choreography now or going into that?
So in anything that's done, and a lot of this comes from the team and being able to be around the team, the priority previously and for a lot of people is often how quickly they can utilize a skill set in order to gain an advantage. But if you develop a skill set, then you end up having the leverage in any situation that you deal with, because now you're the person that has the most skill, and also you're the person that can do the most, and you can pass it to people the more that you understand something inside and out. And so I've been training for the past 3 years with different stunt people. The stunt coordinator for Power, the person is teaching me right now. He was on the last season of Wu-Tang that just came out. And I've been learning from them not only how to do stunt acting and stunt performance and do like fights and falls and stuff, but also the understanding of how the business works and how to work with stunt performers and what the stunt world is like. Because once you go into that environment, just like anywhere else, there's politics and there's exercise and there's soreness and there's communities of people. And if you know how that world operates when you're outside of it, when you do have to go inside of it and you don't have a choice, or if you want to go inside of it because you understand it, you can, again, not move like prey and operate with extreme certainty. And people will see how you move. They will see that you understand. They won't know why you know what you know, but they'll know what you know. And so they won't try to take advantage of you. And so in the practice that's been done and the people that I've been studying under, the goal is to have an understanding of how stunts work, so that I can direct stunt performers and so that I can take direction as a stunt performer when the need comes. Because when you black, you're not going to be out here doing kung fu. They're going to have you falling on your face. You probably want to play a drug dealer. But if you take the understanding of what stunt performance is and what it means, you stay safe. There's a story my teacher tells me where he was on the set of a Marvel movie or a Marvel film. And there was a person that decided he was going to move a pad after the stunt performer had drilled a whole bunch of times. So the stunt performer is committed to the fall because he's done with the pad. And because he didn't know the homie, he goes for the fall and misses the pad and he hits the back of his head and dies immediately. That's because the safety wasn't in place. And the safety wasn't in place because the person on set didn't understand the way the stunt people operate. I don't want to be that person.
That is cold, hard facts. Especially after hearing this latest tragedy on this movie Dust that Alec Baldwin is in and giving a prop gun. And there's so much that's gone on with that, that we've seen that type of accident happen before with Brandon Lee. We've seen that happen. And there's checks and balances. There's just checks and balances. Sometimes you like, you know, there's conflicting stories that's being heard about and everything else. Bottom line, this man feels responsible for the injuring of one person and the death of another because of not his incompetence, but the incompetence of someone around him.
Lack of information.
Lack of information. There it is.
Because, you know, for one thing, you know, I teach firearms too, so I'm into guns. I like guns. So, you know, one of the first things when it comes to firearm, and the most important is safety.
Mm-hmm.
And you treat every firearm as if it's loaded.
Mm-hmm.
So if that gentleman at least knew the fundamentals of how to properly hold a firearm, he would second guess everything. You know, okay, someone hands it to me, is it loaded? How does it look? Okay, should I test fire a couple times? You know, things do happen, accidents do happen, but you know, you have to take that in consideration. You know, people try to get rid of guns or blame guns, but it's not necessarily the guns, it's the
right
people. The people. Stupid people.
Yeah.
Well, not necessarily stupid, they just don't have the information. They're not stupid.
Well, no, I mean it. The misinformed is going to be the misinformed, but you have two people who get guns and go out here just thinking because they know how to handle a gun, you know what I mean, that they can just... Guns don't kill people. Stupid people kill people. That's just how that works. But yeah, gun safety is important, but taking away guns is not always the answer. I mean, some people shouldn't own guns, but that's neither here nor there.
And I like that you framed it as misinformed because a lot of people don't know. And that's like across the board on almost anything, but it's specifically for firearms, because I'm team, you know, firearms. I'm not ever going to be a person that's like, nobody should have guns, because I don't see that as a problem either. But the lack of people being informed about it, especially if we're just going to keep it about people of color. I just think a lot of people I know, they know how to get their license and they know where to get the gun, but then that's kind of where it starts and stops. Mm-hmm. And it's no further conversation or training or anything beyond for a couple of hours. I went to the range and that was it. And I'd want to know way more than that, because this is going to be a lifetime relationship with my piece. Like, yes. That's just what it's going to be. So yeah. I kind of need to know everything. Mm-hmm. And it's very sad what happened on that set, because I feel like things like that are preventable.
It's like cooking. You read all the ingredients the first time, you put stuff in there, you feel good about yourself. But do you really feel like you can do that, make it the same way the very next time without using the instruction book?
Hell
exactly.
No.
Exactly.
It takes a couple times.
It takes a couple times, right.
Fishing at it and be comfortable to make a dish or dessert without, you know, using the book. And it's the same thing with the firearms. But yeah, it's,
man.
But, you know, it happens. And that's an example of what Lee was talking about.
I'm going to show another clip and then we're going to talk about your animes.
Hey. Let me see those hands again.
jump, 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 jump. Everybody jump, 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 jump. Now listen, some of y'all know how to do this, some of y'all don't. Some of y'all might be with this, some of y'all won't, but listen. Let me clear my throat. Let's go, y'all. Oh, say what? Have mercy, baby. Ha, I hope y'all don't mind. City, Mr. Bismarck, grab the mic and get busy.
Can I trick it?
Yes, you can.
You know that I can do it with the mic in my hand.
Yeah.
You remember that? Oh, oh, one, two, go.
I went late that time. I was still mesmerized. Dope shit, man.
I love the fact that you, and this goes in martial arts at all times, you know, to kind of pass that down, to show that next generation how to do things. And this was a fine example of you going over the choreography and the moves that need to be made during said scene. Like we just discussed before the clip, we've heard the accidents, you know, all the time, you know, what happened. You mentioned, Lee mentioned the accident on the Marvel film. You know, I mentioned what happened on the film with Alec Baldwin and then the film with Brandon Lee. These things are unfortunate mishaps or accidents and people's lives.
And, you know, lost. Although people may not be killed every time, which is why those two incidents are such a big deal, I do think about when people are practicing and maybe you accidentally hit somebody full force. Cause I think Daniel Craig was talking about that recently in his last Bond film, where I forget who he said he was opposite of, but he hit him and he was just like, holy shit, are you okay? And fortunately the person like ate the hit, but I'm also like, I don't know if you can hit me and I just lean with it, rock with it. I just feel like,
no, I'm good.
I feel
good,
like that
man.
Takes a certain amount of discipline and focus because it could unfortunately happen. So has it ever happened with you guys where you're practicing something and then somebody accidentally clap and then it's like, all right, give me a minute because I want to beat your ass. Or I don't know if you guys ever felt that.
All the time.
All the time? Keep it real. That's right. I know that's right.
Have a open relationship with one another. So if someone on the outside looking in, they would know that we people on the outside looking in, they will see that we have a great relationship. So they wouldn't see that we were purposely trying to hit one another. But mistakes do happen to where someone will clip someone, but it's all good. You know, we understand it comes with the territory. But if it was someone that we're working with that is new, well, for me personally, and I'm working with somebody, I don't care how much money I'm getting, you're not going to keep hitting me, you know?
I know, that's right.
Yeah.
You might have to catch these hands and do this one more time.
He said, all right.
One time, maybe, you know what I'm saying?
You said you only got so many times to say, I'm
one
sorry.
One too many times, brother. You done slipped on accident.
That last thing that everyone saw, it was a collaboration with a younger gentleman that is someone that I actually look up to. He's a great dude. He's a VFX artist, animation, and he's been doing it since he was 3-5 years old too. So yeah, and we're actually doing collaboration. So when we're talking about the anime martial arts choreography, over my years of doing martial arts, like I said, I only thought I was good at martial arts. I started to get into anime, and I'm actually watching Baki right now, and I'm starting, and I love and I respect within the martial arts anime or anime itself how it makes the correlation between martial arts and, you know, the choreography, the philosophies, the understanding, the principles. In other words, they talk about certain things that sometimes only martial artists will understand, and I love that, you know. So I started to implement that in choreography. I started to I'm creating new content that is more on the side of anime. And then we ran into Caleb, and we're actually creating a piece called Wind Saga. And he's behind a lot of the VFX, the special effects. And I choreographed pretty much all of that. And it's going to be 2v2, 1v2, and it's going to be dope. The trailer is actually coming out soon. Whenever he drops it,
okay.
I'll get it.
Definitely.
Yes. Let us promote. Support, support.
So we're going to talk anime for a hot second. Lee, I know now the question is consistently asked throughout the blurred community, their favorite anime. You know, what is the worst anime?
Ooh.
The worst anime is so bad that you can't watch it. You can only watch the trailer. And it is by the name of Boku no Piku. Now, for those who are uninitiated, don't look it up.
I was about to be like,
she's just Googling away.
You better have incognito on. You better have a VPN before you put it in because it will ruin.
No, for real?
Yeah.
Not the VPN. Not the VPN, though. I'm through.
Not safe for work.
Oh man, not safe.
I am done.
That should be the initials, not NS.
I hear
NSW.
Groovy's keyboard hitting hard over there. One more time, what is that again? Slowly this time, now, young man. Slow down now.
So, Sequence, what was the worst anime for you?
Oh my goodness. I'm very anything that doesn't pertain to martial arts that I can relate to is trash.
Mm. Yeah. Okay.
Well,
okay.
There's that.
Oh, I believe him, yo. I don't know why, but I do.
He said what he said.
Okay. So, I obviously you're wearing your Naruto shirt.
Yeah.
Is that your favorite?
I grew up on it. I have a lot of stories. I told B that last time. It was a few stories I think I mentioned. So basically, Naruto is that one, and everyone has that show, that anime, that nostalgia that appears when you're thinking of that. Or
yeah.
So growing up, I would watch. For example, I would stay up past my bedtime on Saturdays to watch Naruto, to the point where I would not get enough rest. I got to go to church the next morning. I don't get up. Or I get up in church for falling asleep because I was watching Naruto the night before, you know, Toonami. So, and then
shout out to Toonami.
Still going.
Still going strong.
And it was like I said, it's just that nostalgia of my childhood, my early childhood. Naruto was there for me. If anyone wasn't or anything wasn't, Naruto was. So that's why I hit it my top.
Lee, who was your stepbrother anime show that was there for you all the time?
Game. To be honest, fam, when I got into anime, I got into it for all the wrong reasons. So for the first 2 years, watching mad harems, and there's one called Sora no Otoshimon, which is Heaven's Lost Property. And it's about this dude who just wants peace and quiet, but he's also a pervert. And this angel falls
from the sky. Is that Jared from Subway?
And the angel can grant any wish that he has. So because man is a pervert, he engages in wildness for the first day. But then he realizes that, like, I need to protect this thing because this is, like, a pure blessing that I've been given from the freaking heavens. And so, although he still engages in shenanigans, he comes to understand that protecting those that he cares about is how he can ultimately get to that peace that he wants. So, Sora no Otoshimono was that show for me. And I can't watch it anymore because there's mad panty shots, but there's also action. And it's hilarious, and the plot is dope. There's philosophy in there.
And once again, Groovy's keyboard is probably typing away.
They said it was Asian schoolgirl does what now?
No, Lord.
Here you go. Here. I knew it. Groovy's on the case. He says his worst. Groovy says his worst is Fooly Cooly. That is a weird one. Fooly Cooly is a weird one.
Dang. This is the name.
It's a different vibe.
Oh, don't do Space Dandy like that.
Space Dandy.
Don't do Space Dandy like that.
Oh, so out of all the animes that are out, and we're getting inundated with them all the time. What is your standout moment from an anime? Like it's like that moment. It's sort of like hearing John Wick, hearing the story of John Wick killing three people with a pencil, and then you finally see him kill three people with a pencil. What is the moment you from an anime that stood out for you? You're just like, yo, that's that scene, that's that move, that was that moment that did it.
Lee?
High School of the Dead Matrix boobs is easily the greatest anime moment I've ever witnessed with my two eyeballs.
Time out. Because I want to make sure I heard what I heard. Run that back one more time. High School Demon, Matrix boobs.
High School of the Dead is like The Walking Dead, but it takes place in Japanese high school. This person shoots off a machine gun while this girl is fighting zombies with a katana. And so the machine gun fires off. You see the trail of the bullet. Homegirl dodges the bullet, but her boobs are swinging. As she's dodging the bullet. And so it's at perfect timing, it goes whoosh. And the bullet goes. And it just barely goes past in the middle of the fight.
I thought I was tripping.
No, you weren't.
It's been a long day. I just wanted to make sure I wasn't.
You want to make sure you heard what you heard.
Yeah, because right. I was like, my man said mega boobs. You know what I'm saying? It was what the dude say on Boomerang. I heard titties, but I knew I knew because I was drunk.
Diner.
What about you?
I'm old.
What about
your sequence?
I'm old. Bye.
Make me stand up and go crazy, and my girlfriend got to come in here and tell me to shut up because we're like trying to figure out what's going on because I'm so certain scenes that just made me want to stand up. But since I'm watching Baki, there was a because you know I'm biased when it comes to martial arts. There was a scene with what was so important to me that I love. There was I'm pretty sure you remember this, Lee. There was the moment where y'all remember the. If y'all watched it, it was the Muhammad Ali arc in Baki. Hanma was the greatest fighter in this show, Baki's dad, Hanma. And he was the most feared. But he respected Muhammad Ali so much because martial arts goes beyond just the fighting arena. It goes into your everyday life. It goes into your friends and family. You have to be able to relate that information to your everyday life. He respected Muhammad Ali. He gave homage to Muhammad Ali because of the trials and triumphs he had outside of the ring, which was, you know, standing up for the Black culture, the Black community, being that figure amongst everyone that was against him, you know, and that there was beautiful to me. You know, if y'all haven't seen it, y'all have to see it. The way he broke it down. And the thing is, you wouldn't have known that he was talking about that up until
unless you know the story about Muhammad Ali.
Yeah, until that conversation arise. But leading up to that, like I said, he's Hama's the most feared, the strongest. But you can tell, I saw it coming because I'm a martial artist. I understood what Hama was going. He was saying that he wasn't the greatest in a way. You know, he was saying Muhammad Ali was the greatest. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Because of the things that he accomplished on and off the ring. And that's one of the things that make a great martial artist a great martial artist, is them being a great human being.
Yeah. I love how your levels of anime, and you can correlate them with not only just martial arts, but the way of life or how to live the life, you know, how to move through the shadow, so to speak, and get everything taken care of. And I think that's dope. Are you reading any mangas? And what manga do you wish they actually did as an anime or would be a good anime?
So I'm not watching any, I'm not reading any manga right now. I used to growing up. I won't say I don't have time. I just haven't made enough time to do so because I'm so busy. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to stop it there. Yeah, I don't read.
That's gonna be a headline before people get it twisted and be like, "Oh man, that boy Sequence don't read. He don't have time to read. He's a busy man.
The man is
like,
busy. Oh, he don't read." If you follow him on IG, you'll see this man is really busy. He's busy.
right now.
What about you, Lee?
So, weird thing is, I can't read new manga oftentimes because I'm thinking about the stuff that I've already read. And I enjoy stuff like Vagabond. And Vagabond is the written account of Miyamoto Musashi, who's the greatest ronin of all time. And Musashi wrote a book called Gorin no Sho, which is the Book of Five Rings. Mm-hmm. And it's the book that I live my life by. It's like the Bible for anybody that enjoys the concept of a ronin. And it shows you how to live life on your terms by having an understanding of the relationships that things have with each other and the types of things that exist and how you can integrate that within yourself and see that both in and outside of yourself. So I read Vagabond, and I just want to read it over and over and over and over again, because every time I read it, there's something new that I find in it. There's a fight that he had with someone who has a Kusarigama, which is the chain sickle. And he realized that the chain sickle is impossible to fight if you view it as one weapon. You have to view it as the three weapons that it is. And in order to fight it, you have to see it as each individual weapon that it is at each point of contact that you have, which requires you to control your perception and have a mastery over yourself in the way that you see things in order to not die in combat.
Once again, you believe in God and anime. That's all the power you need. But recently on Netflix, there was an anime that dropped. Everybody was excited for it because it's based off a true story. That's the story of Yasuke, the only black samurai in possibly written existence. But there wasn't much story because it was such an old story. There's not much to tell. I don't know if the two of you even seen that series.
Yeah, I see.
What was your thought? By the way, this was voiced by Lakeith Stanfield, so I have thoughts, but we'll let you guys talk about it. So go ahead, Sequence.
I'm not gonna touch too much on it, because I'm not really too bothered about things that they can do. I kind of knew they wasn't gonna cover too much, so I just went in there already like to watch it just to enjoy it. I watched it to enjoy it, so I actually enjoyed it. I didn't have my hopes too high for it, but I'm pretty sure Little Lee has more background and information on it if he would like to hear it.
His eyes are lighting up. It's like he wants it out.
But you said it. He was like, he's so been buying his time.
Go ahead, Lee.
It was interesting enough.
So, if we look at Yasuke as an individual anime, independent of anything else, what we see is a case study. And in order to understand how and why Yasuke is the way that it is, we have to understand the man that created it, LaShawn Thomas. Now, LaShawn Thomas is a black artist. And this man is the reason the Boondocks looks like an anime. Because if you look at the comic strip, the style is different. That stylistic shift is because of LaShawn Thomas. And he decided that he loved anime so much that he wasn't going to go to Japan. He was going to go to Korea, where they make anime. And so he went to Korea and learned the Korean style of animation and the animation pipeline. Then he worked for Warner Brothers for years. He had a huge hand in the visual development of Legend of Korra. And after all these things, this black man that went over to Asia to understand how the cartoons that we love get made came back here and became the head of animation at Netflix. So as a black artist, I look at his story and I learn a lot from his story because he went to do something and he accomplished it. So what we're seeing in Yasuke, what we see in Cannon Buskers, is the fruit of someone who wanted to realize their vision. And his vision was to create what he had in his sketchbook. And he succeeded in that regard. However, as artists, it's important for us to remember
the case study. He's saying it like a professor too.
Exactly. So as artists, we need to learn from certain projects that are released. And what we should learn first and foremost is that the skill of drawing and the skill of visual development and the skill of writing are two very different things, and that there's no shame at all in working with a writer, working with a team, in order to make sure that the concept that we have ends up fully realized and properly executed. Are y'all familiar with Todd McFarlane?
Yes.
Yes.
So Todd McFarlane wants to make a Spawn movie, but the problem is he wants to make the Spawn movie and control the entire thing. And that's why the movie doesn't exist yet. He is an artist that can do literally everything, but because he doesn't want to give away control, the project he wanted to create based on his concept doesn't exist. So as artists, we have to remember that it's okay to work with a team, and we have to learn how to build teams so that what we want to exist gets made. And being a part of the team of ninjas that I have has taught me this lesson very well.
Well, damn. So I've seen the series. Visually, I thought it was great. I just had a problem with some of the voice work that Lakeith had. Just certain scenes of the voice work that Lakeith Stanfield did. And I like him as an actor. I don't know if he's... I think this is his first time doing some like voice work. So I'm not really... grasping it. But otherwise than that, it looked great. I like the storyline, and hearing about this real life character, I'm like, oh, it'd be great. But if you don't really have a lot to base it off of, then I'm okay with what we got, because you can't be mad. You really can't be mad if there's no other written text to go by, you know. Like, I mean, you can touch on some things. I mean, it's some things that can.
I had one because I heard it wasn't. It started out kind of strong, but then it that was it. The opening was great, and then it was just like after that, it was touch and go. It was on life support real fast. And I was like, man, I don't know. I shouldn't go by word of mouth, but it was some trusted informants, and they
trusted informants.
They ain't let me long yet. You know what I'm
saying? Yeah, you're right. It's important. If you want to be the dude with a black anime, you got to go to the black anime people and see what they think about it. Like, we live in the internet era. We no longer live in an era where you have to wait 15 years for something to exist. If you want something to get made, it can be made in 1 year. And you can know what certain members of the community think about that. That's the whole reason NBA exists. And so there's not much of an excuse to be in compromising positions when you can control the narrative and the project that gets released.
Yeah.
So
I have a burning question before we get there.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I love it. I don't know if everybody, a lot of people don't, but where do you guys stand on Dragon Ball? Like, just the whole, as a whole.
87% of anybody on the internet that likes anime would not exist without Dragon Ball, and no more Dragon Ball slander will be tolerated if it happens after the Cell Saga. Now, what happened after the Cell Saga, minus Boo, actually, no. If it happened after, was Boo after Cell?
Yeah.
Okay, everything after Boo, it doesn't count. It doesn't matter. Dragon Ball.
Whoa! Hold on, no. I like all the sagas. I mean, up until the last one was kind of weird, where they was going to erase the planet, but, you know, we never know if they did. But they're not supposed to be bringing that back around.
I get what you're saying.
See, Lee, I thought I was the only one who felt like that. Anything after the Boo?
No.
I mean, I get it.
It got kind of weird.
Because it was hard to track. It did get weird. Like, even the Broly saga, the film that they did, you know, it was
I did like that one.
I mean,
but I'm not gonna lie, I've been watching it since it first started, like even back like in the high school days. When I was in high school, we used to run home to watch that. So I got a special part for that in my heart. I'm not gonna lie.
Well, like Lee said, it's
just the end. It was like, find out next time on Drake. That shit right there had me hooked, because the motherfucker, the way that nigga stopped that shit in the middle of the nigga's fight and had your ass waiting for a whole week to come back to see what was gonna happen. Fuck all that. I don't care what nobody say. That and Power Rangers was my shit, man. You talk about a place in my heart, boy. I tell you, running home to see those two. Yeah, but yeah, it did get weird after the Boo. It got kind of weird. Hercule became like this super.
Hercule.
We pretty much, anyone who's been watching this since the beginning, we pretty much tolerate anything that comes after the Boo saga.
Yeah. It's like, you know, your crackhead uncle gonna steal stuff, but you love him enough that you're gonna let him over anyway. You just watch him closely though.
Anything after the Boo Saga is like the crackhead uncle. You watch it closely, but you don't put too much effort into it.
But right? No, you do that's have a point. Right. We do let a lot of shit slide after Boo. All
right, so and DBZ. Those were the legends right there. So if you mm-hmm. you watched those or grew up on those or started with those, it was one of the top three. I mean, if you tolerated up to the Boo Saga, I mean, you tolerate the rest of it. But you're not tolerating up to the Boo because it was well thought out, you know.
Yeah. Yeah.
It lost something after the Boo, you know. And GT don't count. Fuck GT.
No, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, GT got weird. I don't know what the fuck that was. The other one,
I got off the rail after
Super
GT.
Heat, Dragon like, Ball yeah. Super Heroes, that shit they tried with the dude who looked like, but it had that weird planet where everybody was like fucking, I don't know the name of this shit, but it was like, because I couldn't
Dragon
watch
Ball
it.
Super.
It was no, like, no. This was something totally different than Super.
Heroes.
Dragon Ball Heroes.
Oh, the Heroes. Okay. Yeah. Oh.
Super Saiyan 4 fights Super Saiyan Blue.
Yeah. I mean, they had some dope fights, dope concepts, but it was just like, it was a weird ass, like these niggas was on like Fight Island and it was just like,
yeah, it was just... yeah, for the video game. It's a commercial for the video game. That's all it is. Yeah.
No, they had a cartoon. Yes, this was the they had a cartoon.
Yeah, that's
just
what
like
saying.
He-Man is a commercial for the toy.
Okay, yeah, okay.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah.
Now I can dig it. Okay, I'll give it a little more. Yeah, his name was Mr. Satan, and it was Hercule at the same time. Like, this nigga didn't know who the fuck he was. He had a real identity crisis. Like, Hercule, like, I forgot how he got his money.
He was the strongest fighter in the world.
Oh,
was he?
That was all. But that was his always.
Yeah, he was
his
definitely
tag.
Like Hulk Hogan
on Earth.
Yeah,
he was definitely out here.
He was the Hulk Hogan of Earth. That's what he was.
This nigga out here, say your prayers, eat your vitamins. I'm Mr. Satan.
And didn't he the fighting arena, the tournament? Like he was there.
Yeah, he got his ass whooped.
Yeah.
No, he won it. Yeah.
So, it's just like, anything after, like I said, like the Broly saga, the film, you know, dope fight scenes, a lot of shit going on, but you could tell in the animation how, like, it was older in certain scenes, and you could really tell, you know, although the funniest thing I pulled from that movie was when Vegeta and Goku left, go get Piccolo, and Piccolo was just like, yo,
Piccolo's no, can we I agree Piccolo was a nigga? Like, I don't care what nobody say, Piccolo was a true brother. He was not trying to bother nobody. You know what I'm saying? This nigga was like, hey man, don't be bringing that shit over here. I'm trying to chill, got shorty on the way, got some, you know what I'm saying? Just trying to relax.
He's like, I'll tell you what to do, but I'm not coming with you.
The funny part to me is when they had to fight Broly at the end, and Vegeta and Goku left. Broly's beating beating Frieza's ass.
Oh, yeah, he was beating the fuck out of Frieza. let's not go past that because that part might have been the funniest part because this nigga Frieza was like, oh yeah, I'm about to chill. This nigga looked at Frieza was if on site was a person, this nigga looked at Frieza. And in the words of my nigga No More Larry, it was on bumpers. He went at that nigga. Hey, he was beating Frieza into a mountain. And this nigga Frieza like, get your dirty hands off me, you dirty ape. And he was beating the shit out of this nigga. Gave him all kind of rights. Let me, bow. Hit him with an uppercut. Threw this nigga in the mouth. This nigga went gold. Was like, I've had enough of this shit. And got his nigga beat even more.
Oh, man.
God rest the soul of the dude who played Frieza. But that nigga was like, I had enough of this shit. And got his nigga beat even more. That shit.
Yo, I was watching it in the theater. It was
and that,
like,
that plot, hold on, Groovy made
right.
a point. Groovy made a point because that plot line never made sense to me. How Broly was mad at Goku, who he never seen because this nigga was crying so much as a baby. Like that fucking beginning was kind of weird.
Yeah,
like
and that's what I'm saying. Like everything, that's what we were saying. Like everything.
He beat his ass so bad that he brought back memories of that cry. Like. This nigga beat Goku so bad, he started crying movie. Like a baby and pissed Broly off even more. This nigga was like, oh, this nigga that was crying, kept me up all goddamn night. Beat the shit out of him even more.
I've noticed, like, I watched Super, like, several times. I watched it the first time when it was coming out, and then I decided to watch it the second time, then the third time. The more you watch Super, you start to see that you started Saturn in Dragon Ball.
Yeah, it does.
Yeah.
It has somewhat no substance. It seems like there's a lot going on, but it really ain't a lot going on.
No.
It's just entertaining. We always wanted to.
But see, once again, it was the thing that got us started.
Yeah, yeah.
It was the one that got it. So we're gonna hold a special place for it because Krillin. I stumbled upon. Yeah,
fucking nope. Yamcha is the fucking most useless character in the history. I'd rather have Mr. Popo than motherfucking Yamcha. This nigga. Dende served some purpose. This nigga Yamcha wasn't shit.
He tried to be in the camp.
Tien was cool. Yeah. This nigga Yamcha was in shit.
Yamcha was the one that was just like, yo, I'm in this group. I'm in the crew.
Quiet as it's kept, Gohan wasn't all that. He was cool as a kid, but then he got old. He got soft as fuck. And he lost everything.
Yeah, because he said so he kind of
became useless. This nigga became the Great Saiyan Man and all that shit.
If he would have became the main character like he was supposed to, I think. Yeah. Dragon Ball Z,
because Sarah watched him. I'm like, dude, what? You talked all that stuff.
And I have to admit, Goku.
Yeah, we would have loved it for what it was when we was watching it growing up. We would love it.
Yeah, Goku is trash. I'm gonna have to say that. Not a trash character. He's just the worst father ever. No, he was toxic. We have to admit, Goku was toxic. I mean,
oh, Goku was definitely toxic.
He was always on fighting, and he never took care of none of his kids. Like, none of them. Wasn't there for not one birth, one.
That's why
this thing ain't seen not one of his kids walk, but he seen him fight.
Yeah.
What anime y'all watching now?
What did I just leave off with? Actually, I'm not. Oh, I'm finishing Attack on Titan. Since I have time before they drop the next half of the other season. So other than that, that is it. Everybody's telling me JoJo has a new season, so I'm like, okay, I guess I'll watch JoJo.
You haven't watched any of JoJo?
No, I've watched the first two seasons of JoJo.
Okay. What about you, DC?
I don't have time. I ain't gonna lie to you. When I get a chance, if it's on Toonami and I'm awake or physically, I've had some suggestions. See, my problem was I tell this story before. I got caught up in hentai first. Somebody tricked me into thinking I was watching anime and it was fucking hentai, so that fucked me up for life. I can't just see the shit the same no more. I was dating this girl and was at her house. She's like, "Hey, you want to watch this anime?" I was like, "Cool," and it was like fucking tentacle porn and shit, and it was just like the wildest shit I've ever seen in my life. I was like, you scarred me. Like, I can't go back to some normal shit after this. Like, what the fuck am I supposed to do with this normal stuff? So, but no, I do want to get into some other stuff. I'm waiting on the Cowboy Bebop to come on Netflix. I kind of want to see that.
Yes.
And then I'll go watch the anime version.
Yeah, Cowboy live action Cowboy Bebop.
Live action version.
Yeah.
I know it's not the same.
The only show that had one season and it's still like top tier.
But I've seen some of Cowboy Bebop back in the day.
Watanabe made it.
Yeah. I was introduced. I stumbled. Yeah. Yes. Yes. I stumbled across Dragon Ball years ago when we had the big satellite in the backyard. And like it got knocked offline, and so we had to manually use the control to find the station. And me and my brother, I'm like, "What cartoon is this?" And this is when Goku was a kid. So we were catching it. We're catching it at the beginning. Man. You know, we're catching that
regular Dragon Ball.
Regular Dragon Ball. So we were like, "I'm like, yo!" And so once we figured out like the timing, and we had the signal down, we were watching that joint every week. And that got me onto it. We had a public access channel in Akron, and on Friday nights, they used to show ECW, and then after ECW, they would show like Crying Freeman, Lupin the Third.
Lupin was dope too.
Yeah, they would show also. I was introduced to those around 14, 15. So yeah, nice. I was really soaking those up then, like, people like crying. Friedman, what's that? I'm like, yo, he was an assassin, but he hated, like, he would cry for his enemies every time he did it, you know. So Lupin the Third was like my first funny anime to watch and was really into it. So Cowboy Bebop came later. Dragon Ball was already on the mark. So yeah, I was introduced to that stuff early.
Lupe still like Lupin the Third.
Classic. But yeah, Goku was a trash father. Piccolo was the dude. Piccolo was always that dude to me. So yeah. Yes, but yeah, I'm finishing off Attack on Titan. I see Baki has a new season, so I'll check it out.
It's straight. Sorry. Yeah. I like the first.
I'll check out the rest of JoJo, because here's the thing that people don't understand about JoJo. They had a bomb soundtrack at the end. Their end credits. They have bomb soundtrack in credits. So I'm like, I'll have to check. I'll finish that off, because you know JoJo can be weird, but it's hard to, if you're not paying attention, it's hard to keep up with. My hero this season was I don't know if it's because it's like it's too much going on at the school. I'm like, I'm tired of seeing the school tournaments. You know,
yeah, like, you don't like people getting their education, Chris?
No,
I can see the headline now. Chris Fury hates education. Now they got their mind banning schools.
Banning schools. Oh my god. The thoughts and processes of Chris Fury do not reflect the themes of Blurred's Eye View. I'm mustering through that. Hell, I'm still finishing off Titans. And that's only because Young Justice popped back up. So, but you're right, Lee.
Oh, wait. Oh, forgot about that.
Yeah. Yeah. Man, Young Justice was back.
I haven't watched it yet because I want to go back, because I felt like it was too long between the third season and the fourth season. So I feel like I missed a lot. So I got to go back and start from the beginning, because I feel like it's only right if I'm a. Because they lost me, because I was like, I heard they was getting canceled. And I was like, well, fuck, if they're getting canceled, I ain't about to
finish it off. And that's what it seemed like. And then they turn around and they sprung the family.
They got canceled like 3-4 times, though. Like, they like canceled more than
every
time.
Like, they're canceled, and then somebody drags it out of the mud. I'm like, hey, no, it's back. And like, that's what I thought. Like, after that last season, I thought that was it. And then, like, Warner Brothers and DC had that DC fandom, and they were dropping all the news, and they were like, and you can catch the first two episodes of the new season of Young Justice Phantoms. And I'm like, when the hell did it drop? You know, so
today
I watched the two seasons, the first two episodes, and I'm like, like you said, DC, I had to watch the last two episodes of the previous season, because I was like, it had been that long.
Man, I was seeing the cover, and I was like, who the fuck is these guys? It was like some people on there I ain't seen it never. I was like, hey, I'm gonna have to go back, because they didn't change this team 60 times.
They keep some of the main core crew.
I seen Superboy on there.
Megan, Garfield. I don't know what they're going to do with live action Titans. I got to finish that season anyway.
Oh, yeah. That's good. You missed it.
Yeah, I got to finish that one off. I'll probably finish that.
So glad they put Red Hood in it, finally making Titans.
Yeah. I'm not going to lie. It was kind of a letdown.
It's because the guy is so squirrely. He had that squirrely voice. When he has the helmet on.
I just felt like he played like the Red Hood. He played Red Hood the shit out of it.
Yeah.
And it was just the way he was going. It was like a drug-induced Red Hood. And I didn't feel like he was like dependent on Scarecrow. And I was like, what the fuck is this? Like, Red Hood stand up for Red Hood. He didn't need this motherfucker. And Scarecrow was a hippie. This nigga just smoked weed all day.
Yeah, the shows always do a really.
They do.
Yeah. Shows, I think, do a really bad job of just telling the story, and they try to make it easier for regular people that are into comics. Yeah. But the comic story is perfect. Doesn't need to be changed.
Oh my god. The animated movie Into the Red Hood was fucking
Amazing. Under the Red Hood. Under the Red Hood's fucking great.
Perfect.
And it's told in a way, like, you can literally watch that and not be a purveyor of the comics and say, yo, this was good.
Yeah, believe right. Good. They dumbed that live action down for the lowest common denominator people. It's like, oh, you know Batman. You know Robin. Well, here's Red Hood and Scarecrow, and we're going to water it down so you can understand and follow everything.
Yeah, I'm still not digging this old Bruce Wayne. Not that version anymore.
Oh, that nigga. Oh, my God. That Bruce Wayne couldn't kick a motherfucking paper bag down the street the way he looked. I wasn't feeling the Bruce Wayne. Other than that, I mean, other than Bruce Wayne.
Yeah, that was really the only thing I really wasn't feeling.
And the Red Hood story arc, I was cool with everything else. Knighthood, Robin became Nightwing. And, you know what I mean? I mean, Beast Boy still can only do three animals, but he's learning. You know what I mean? It's just true. Like, this nigga can do, he got a bat by accident. And no, he can only do two, right?
Yeah, he did the snake. He did the snake by accident. Oh, he did the snake.
Yeah, the snake.
He did the tiger. He knew how to do the tiger. He did the snake by accident. That's the only thing he
know how to do. This nigga's a one-trick pony. And this nigga know how to do the tiger. He'd be a horrible child entertainer. All right, guys, you want to see some animals? Lion. Now I'm a lion on my hind feet. I'm a lion in a corner. Look, you like, do something else.
Lion.
But
they do nothing but fucking tigers.
So before we get out of here, we'll start with you, Sequence. Tell everybody where they can find you.
Well, first for starters, you guys can follow me on IG on my cosplay page. It's actually on the screen there. Dat Ronin, DatBoy Ronin. And my marketing page is Fist Ronin. And I'm also on Facebook as Sequence Henry.
There you go. Lee.
So, people, I'm Lee Juaso. LeeJuaso. That's how you spell Juaso. So, if you want to find me, go to the home of Black Anime Street, where 160% profits goes directly to all artists on the website. Over 50 artists on the website. Over 200 products on the website. JuasoGraphics.com. JuasoGraphics.com for all your Black Anime streetwear needs. In terms of martial arts training things, that is on RONIN.JUASO.
Bro, I need to work on my book, man. I like that.
Yeah, I'm like, man, he sold the hell out of that.
I do not make me follow that because I ain't got the energy. Shit.
I'll tell you what, I will go first.
You can follow me. Fuck that. I'm not about to follow that.
I tell you what.
I like his energy, though, man.
Yeah, it was fly. It was fly. So you can find me here. Just go to the link tree. You can find all everything Chris.Fury1 on IG, Blurred's Eye View, all one word on IG. But if you just go to either one of those pages on IG and go to the link, the bio in the link tree, everything's there. I can't sell it like Juwasa just did. That was high energy, boy, and I loved it.
So, 10 o'clock at night, he's still on 20. I'm like, I'm like, shit, he had Wheaties, vitamins, and prayers. And
the way of the road.
I'm over here just like, yeah, man, I just, you know, like, I'm just glad to be here.
Tell them where they can find you, DC.
Shit. I don't even know now.
We went from 20 to 10 to 5.
Yeah, you can find me on IG at whattheshit_podcast. Also, Darius DC Chambers, all one word. On Facebook, it's What The Stuff Podcast. Fuck Mark Zuckerberg. You know what the fuck you did, nigga? You out here disrespect for the homies. And, you know, so you can find us there. The link tree's in the bio on Instagram. And, you know, thank you. I'm happy to see you guys here, man. It was a great time.
Definitely. We got to have you guys back. I want to thank our guests, Lee and Sequence, for coming on and telling everyone where they can find you. Be sure to check out Linktree, as I said earlier. And as always, Blurred's Eye View is providing a safe space for blurreds everywhere to showcase their talent, skills, and talk topics. That's only we can. So until next Tuesday, when we talk to...
I like doing this because I like speaking things into existence. Oh. Don't be surprised when you see these young brothers and their teams out here doing the next set of G.I. Joe and all the rest. I'm talking about, nah, fuck G.I. Joe. They're going to be doing real ass action movies. We're going to be out here.
Keep an eye out.
Keep your eyes out
and your ears Channing closed.
Tatum or Marlon Wayans doing, nah, man, they're going to be doing out here doing real stunts, man, and real movies, man. I see it. because they dope and they about their craft. Yeah,
their minds is in the right place. Their heart is definitely in the right place.
Some Ashley Janae said that made me realize it. You know, water finds its own level.
Yeah.
So shout out to Ashley Janae. The way y'all wavelengths is going, man, and the way y'all water is going, man, y'all gonna be on and popping real soon. Yeah. If not sooner than later, you know what I mean?
They got some dope content. They hearts is in the, like I said, their hearts is in the right place.
But the biggest thing, the right place. They is team over self, and that'll get you everywhere.
Yes.
You know what I mean? Yes. They humble. They about the teamwork. You know what I mean? And you only as strong as your team.
Right.
Yes, but go ahead, man. You know, I just wanted to put it out there in the atmosphere, man, so these brothers can get on and we can say we knew them before they start kicking major ass in Hollywood.
Right.
I do not want to see these brothers doing stunts on Tyler Perry movies. They do badass wigs, and I don't want to see.
I'm pretty sure they would do way better.
I don't
want
to see Madea goes to the dojo or Madea goes back in time and meets Bruce Lee or some bullshit like that. I like Tyler Perry, but I didn't have enough of Madea. She done did a lot, man, in her lifetime. Like, she needed to fucking Madea retires. That's the next movie. God damn.
The dojo.
Oh, I can picture it. I want to learn martial arts. Hello. Get the fuck out of here, man.
Man.
I love Tyler Perry, man, and everything he doing. But if I see one more, Madea enters the dragon. God damn it, if you don't get Madea, have her send her ass home somewhere. Thank you, Groovy. I was thinking of some shit like that, but you said it. I'm trying. Madea, do one more goddamn thing. I'm sorry. I'm like a three-stooge, man. It was cool when it first started in the plays and all that, but now it's just like, what can't Madea do? Like, next she's gonna be Madea becomes a superhero. Madea gonna be a Marvel character. Madea. Her fucking super.
Oh my god. Well, until next Tuesday when we talk geek with other blurs, remember to entertain yourself and others, educate yourself and others, and most of all, like these brothers here with us tonight, encourage yourself and others. And until next mission.
Whoa. I got one more. Got one more shameless plug. If you guys aren't doing anything tomorrow night, Shit will be live. We have a dope couple from Akron who just went viral with their video called Same Chick. It's a husband and wife rap duo. And right now they popping. So T Vix and Miss Dean will be on with their album Zamunda. And Madea will nowhere be found. But again, appreciate you, brother, for coming on. Seriously, being that, man, you guys are dope, and keep doing it. You know what I mean,
we will keep our eyes out for anything that you guys are doing, and hopefully support everything you can do. So you got a home here, Blurred's Eye View.
You got fans here, man. I always tell guests that they leave, if they shit's dope, I'll be like, you have a fan right here, if nobody else, and I mean that shit, because if your shit ain't dope, I'd be like, hey, man, it was nice having you. See you next time, brother. But no, man, you guys is dope, man. So I'm gonna have to make sure I get, because it's been a busy week. I haven't been able to follow people like I usually do, but I'm definitely gonna make sure I check out your content, like, share, comment, man, and put the word out there. My platform ain't big, our platform ain't big, but anything we can do to make sure dope people is seen, we're gonna try to do. So when y'all see a whole bunch of like, what the shit, don't be honest, don't be worried, I'm just sharing a lot of stuff. I do that from time to time, and that's good. Yes. Yes, the melanin hands of gods.
Thank you, Groovy. So, until next mission, Groovy's the man. He's all right. He is all right with me.
Blessing everybody's lives.
He do, don't he? Pop up in the live with Groovy.
Groovy ain't a top fan. Thank you
so much for having us.
Oh, man, we appreciate
y'all.
Yeah, for real. I'm like, we got
to tell people you can go anywhere and go on any shore, man. And I always feel blessed, as you know what I'm saying, when people want to come to us. It's dope. You know what I mean? You be like, because some people you ask, you be like, hey, man, you know, got a podcast, want you guys to come on. They can have 1,000 followers and they think like, oh, nigga, I ain't doing your little show, man. Fuck that shit. So I believe, you know, like I said, water finds its own level. So, you know, people who fuck with you, you got to fuck with them back. So we appreciate it, man. And it's, like I said, it's all love over here. You guys need anything from us, don't hesitate to reach out.
Yeah,
our doors is always open.
Doors are always
unless
open
they're closed. They're not really always. I don't know where I got. That's a saying I got from somewhere, but I know y'all brothers got to go. Yeah, I know. But no, door's always open, man. And I mean that for sure. I like seeing, especially younger cats, man. I like seeing that because we old. Me and Chris, we dinosaurs. Y'all the future, man.
Dinosaurs.
Fuck that, Chris. I'm gonna keep it real, man. We fuck season. We old, man. We one foot closer to the grave, man. That the Grim Reaper sitting over our shoulder any day, waiting, just being like, "Come on, nigga, you know." Checking to see, putting his little bony nose under a little bony finger under our nose just to make sure we still breathe. I mean, it's true. Man.
Oh my god. Yeah,
it's the future, man. I want to make sure the future is in good hands, man. And with people like this, I feel like I ain't got nothing to worry about because one day I'm gonna be old. Yeah,
as long as there's brothers like you, seriously, as long as
people gotta carry like that torch, man. And I want
to. And we know
sure
that
people...
you're out there doing good, and then not only doing good, but then teaching it to the next generation. We know there's still hope. You know, there's still hope out there. So, and
this cat's out here ain't doing nothing, man. Pants, I ain't gonna get on my old man soapbox. Goddamn pants around your goddamn ankles. All that fucking jive music and shit.
What? Anyway, until next mission, we are out of here. We want to thank our guests once again.
Thank you
for coming on. And we got to have you guys back again. But until next mission, this is Chris Fury along with DC. Candy B had to step out. But we are out of here.